Okay, so hi everybody. Welcome to the last MPC session of this Eurocrypt. We have three talks. The first one is Round Optimal Byzantine Agreement by Diana Ghinea, Vipul Goyal, and Chen-Da Liu-Zhang, and Chen-Da is presenting.
Okay. Can you hear me? Yes, okay. Yeah, so thanks for the introduction. I'm very happy to be here today in the round optimality session of MPC. So I'm going to spend the next 20 minutes talking about Byzantine agreement, which is a fundamental building block in the design of MPC protocols. And I'm going to focus on round efficiency and hopefully convince you that one can achieve BA in a very efficient way and yet conceptually simple manner. So what is Byzantine agreement? So this is a distributed protocol among n parties, a bunch of parties. Each party has its own input, and they want to jointly compute an output with two guarantees. The first guarantee is that all the honest parties have to output the same value. And the second guarantee is, well, if all honest parties input the same value x, then this is the value that they should jointly output. Of course, these two guarantees need to hold even when a subset of the parties are corrupted. And well, achieving each of these guarantees independently is very easy, right? But achieving both at the same time is not trivial. So in this paper, we focus on the synchronous model, right? So we consider the setting where parties have synchronized clocks, and they are connected via a complete network of point-to-point authenticated channels with some known delay. And in this setting, we typically describe the protocol as proceeding in rounds. And so basically when someone sends a message in some round, then it's guaranteed to be delivered before the next round. And in this synchronous model, then a crucial efficiency metric is the round complexity or the round efficiency, right? So how many rounds do we need to achieve Byzantine agreement? So let's look at the landscape. So we know for a long time that for deterministic protocols, Byzantine agreements can be achieved in T plus one rounds, right? Where T here is the corruption threshold. We've known this for a long time, and this is not very good, right? Because it means that the round complexity is linear in the number of parties, right? For usual thresholds, n over three, n over two, right? Luckily, we also know that for the case of randomized protocols, the landscape is actually much better. We know here that, the longer you run a protocol, the higher the probability to achieve Byzantine agreement. And from the feasibility side, we know that if you run a protocol for something like C times R rounds, where C is a constant, then we know solutions that achieve Byzantine agreement with very high probability, right? Except with probability 2^-R. And this was initially achieved by Feldman and Micali, right? And since then, there have been a significant line of works improving this constant under different assumptions and also with different corruption thresholds and so on, right? We also know since almost 40 years, the lower bound by Carlin and Yao, that basically says something like, if you have like a linear number of corruptions, then in R rounds, any BA protocol incurs at least some error that has the form r^-r, something like that. So the question is therefore apparent here. So can we close this gap, right? Can we go from 2^-r to r^-r? And this was not known even for any linear number of corruptions and not even for static corruption. And this is what we do in this work. So we present a protocol that essentially closes this gap for any fraction of corruptions up to n half. And we also support adaptive corruptions. So note that the threshold here is up to 1 minus epsilon, so there is still a small gap. And the constant here actually depends on this epsilon. So you can think about it as 1 over epsilon or something like that. Okay, so before we get into this, right, how do we solve this? Let me start with a little bit of background. And this is going to explain a bit one of the most prominent paradigms to design BA protocols. This was initially introduced by Rabin and many, many other people, right? And this is, I refer to it as the seminal paradigm. So in the seminal paradigm, the first thing we do is we run a weak form of agreement, right? Which I call here weak consensus, also known as Crusaders agreement. And the idea here is just imagine that parties start with an input bit, and we are going to expand the domain to a domain of size 3, where parties can output either a bit or bottom. And bottom is here intuitively to capture situations in which parties don't know what to output, right? So what does weak consensus achieve? Well, validity is exactly the same as Byzantine agreement. If all the honest parties input the same bit, then this is the bit that they output, both for 0 and 1. But consistency is weakened slightly. So it is fine that some parties output 0 and bottom. It's also fine that some parties output 1 and bottom, right? There is a little bit of jiggling. But it's not allowed that some honest parties output 0 and other honest parties output 1. And this is depicted in this picture, right? In this array of three positions. You can look at it as like the honest parties output a value in the green region, right? So, and believe me, weak consensus can be achieved in a very simple way, a constant number of rounds, even deterministically. And this paradigm basically bootstraps this goes from weak consensus to full Byzantine agreement via a common coin. So how does this paradigm work? Well, we first run a weak consensus. Each party obtains one of these three values, 0, 1, or bottom. And then we flip a common coin. And for this talk, I'm going to assume that the common coin is completely random, uniform value between 0 and 1. And that everyone gets the same coin value. So the paradigm works as follows. We first run weak consensus. We all jointly flip a coin. And if you don't know what to do with your output, meaning your output of weak consensus was bottom, then you simply take the value of the coin. Otherwise, you have some confidence, right? Then you stick to this value. So if your output of weak consensus was either 0, 1, you stick to it. If it was bottom, you take the coin value. And then we repeat, right? So the effect of this paradigm is basically, well, if all honest parties started from the same input, then after weak consensus, then they all output that input bit, and no one ever listens to the coin. And therefore, this value gets propagated throughout all iterations. And that's what we want. However, if parties start with different values, at least weak consistency guarantees that the output of honest parties lie within the green region, right? Two consecutive slots in the picture. So it can be something like 0 and bottom. And in this case, if we are lucky, if the coin hits 0, then we reach agreement, right? Because the 0 guys stay 0 and the bottom guys take the value of the coin, which is 0. And therefore, the probability of agreement here is at least 1/2. And what is important here is that the output value of weak consensus is independent of the value of the coin, right? That's why we are tossing the coin after weak consensus. And at least intuitively, we can think that with this paradigm, it kind of the iterations are independent, right? And each iteration takes at least 2 rounds, one for weak consensus, one for the coin, right? So the limitation here is that kind of the best we can achieve is in 2 rounds, we can achieve agreement with probability 1 minus 2 to the minus r. So how can we go beyond this, right? So to break this barrier, what we are going to do is we are going to use like a generalized paradigm that was initially introduced by Pizzi, myself, and Loss like last year. And we do something slightly different. So instead of running a weak consensus protocol, we're going to run a so-called proxensus protocol, which is kind of a generalized primitive, where instead of expanding the input domain to a size 3, which is what we do in weak consensus, we're going to expand it to an input to an output domain of size S, where S is some parameter. And proxensus is going to guarantee, again, two properties. First one is validity. We're going to look at the S, the domain S, as positions within an array of size S. And validity guarantees that if the input is 0, then the output of proxensus is the leftmost lot, the one in green, right? And if the input is 1, then you get the rightmost lot. And consistency simply says that, well, the outputs of honest parties lie within two consecutive slots. It can be anywhere in the array, but they need to be together, right? And indeed, this proxensus primitive generalizes many of the weak agreement primitives that we have seen in the literature, including weak consensus that I've talked about, but also others, graded consensus and so on. So how can we use proxensus to achieve Byzantine agreement? Well, we are going to run the proxensus protocol. This is similar to the seminal paradigm, right? And then we're going to flip a coin. And this time the coin will be multivalued, a value between 1 to S minus 1. And then we are going to run some extraction procedure, which based on the output of proxensus and the value of the coin, we are going to extract a bit, right? And in this picture, the extraction procedure is actually very simple. It will only indicate at an inner position where we will cut the array. So for example, here, if the coin takes value 3, we are going to cut the array at that position. And if the output of proxensus was at the left of this cut, then we are going to interpret that the output of the protocol is 0. And if your output position was at the right, then the output will be 1. So why does this work, right? So first, validity. If all honest parties input the same bit, let's say 0, then this means by validity of proxensus, all the honest parties output the leftmost lot. And because we are only cutting at an inner position, it doesn't matter where you cut. All the honest parties will lie to the left side, meaning all honest parties output 0. Similar with 1, right? Why do we have consistency? Well, if you look at the picture, proxensus guarantees that the output of honest parties lie within two consecutive slots, which means that there is only one coin value that will cause disagreement. No matter where you cut, most of the coins will push all the parties to the same side, right? And therefore, like in this picture, the bad coin would be C equals 2, right? And like this, we can reach agreement except with probability 1 over the domain of the coin, right? 1 over S minus 1. Okay, so the trick here will be, can we expand long enough, right? Can we achieve R to the R slots, right? Within R rounds. And in that case, just by flipping one coin, we achieve BA, and that's it. We are done, right? We don't need to iterate or anything. Only one coin will be enough. And this is exactly what we do in this paper. We have a protocol that achieves an expansion in the first step to R to the R slots in a very efficient way. So I'm going to talk about this expansion now. So how does this work? So the parties look at this huge array of R to the R values. And depending on their input, they are going to position themselves in one side or the other. So if the input was 0, they are going to position themselves on the leftmost array, the one in green. And if the input is one, they are going to position themselves there. And the idea is, okay, the honest parties are still very far away, right? But we are going to do a bunch of iterations, and we are going to try to bring the honest parties together, right? They need to be next to each other to achieve proxensus. So how does this work exactly? So, well, a first idea would be, I'm going to just distribute my position in the array to everyone. I'm going to say, I'm in the leftmost slot to everyone, right? And then we are going to take the average somehow. And of course, like this, if everyone was honest, then we immediately reach the same slot, right? Because we are taking an average on the same set of values, right? Of course, this doesn't work because obviously, like, some parties are cheating, right? So some parties can send different values to other parties, and then we take an average over different sets, and then we end up at different positions, right? But yeah, then we just need to distribute the value in a bit more clever way and do the average in a bit more clever way, and this is how we kind of solve it, right? So how are we going to distribute the value? So to distribute the value, we are going to use also a weak form of agreement primitive, right? Which is kind of a proxensus primitive also, but for a single sender. And you can also look at it as a kind of a great gust protocol for those that know about this. And the idea is that if the sender is honest, then this, and he tries to distribute a position X, then everyone gets X. However, if he is dishonest, then some parties get some position Y and other parties get some what I call Y tilde, like looks like Y. Or so the honest outputs lie within two consecutive slots, right? Just like in proxensus. Either the honest parties get Y and Y tilde, or honest parties get Y tilde and bottom, right? And then what is interesting here is that the honest parties will also keep track of who is cheating, right? And here, basically, you know that if you receive a Y tilde or a bottom, you know that the sender is cheating, right? And we are going to exploit this. That will be a key in our protocol. So the distribute step will also guarantee that if everyone knows, everyone locally recognizes the sender as corrupted, then the best the sender can do is just to distribute a bottom. Right? This will be a guarantee of the distribute step. So how does the protocol work? Well, first, the parties distribute this, the position where they are, and now we take some sort of average. Maybe you don't need to understand how this average exactly works, but I'm going to say a few words. So the way this average works is essentially you look at the values that you got, n values. The bottom values are useless, so you just throw them away, right? These are the set C0. And you know these guys are corrupted, right? C0 corrupted parties. So from the remaining ones, the non-bottom values, you are going to do an average, but you are going to discard t minus c0 at the top and t minus c0 at the bottom. And the idea here is that if you do an average on the remaining values, then you are actually doing an average over an interval that is kind of a sub-interval of the honest interval that you had in the beginning. So for example, if after discarding bottom values, you have this array, then you discard top and bottom, and the remaining ones, you do an average, right? Yeah, okay, so here is an example of the protocol. You distribute the protocol to everyone. You do this discarding and trimming. Next iteration, you again distribute your new position. You discard and trim, and so on, right? And the effect of this is, because every time you do an average over an interval that is a subset of the initial honest interval, then validity will be guaranteed, right? If all honest parties start with zero and you do an average of a sub-interval of zero, then it's zero, right? And consistency is slightly more tricky, right? The point here is that how much do parties converge? And the point is that the best the adversary can do is to transmit these white tildes and bottoms, because in that case, some honest parties will take white tilde into account and other honest parties will get bottom, in which case they will discard this value, right? That's the only case where the adversary can cause a little bit of disagreement. But if you look closely, what happens is that then all the honest parties will recognize the sender as corrupted if he sends white tilde and bottom. And therefore, in the next iteration, PI is identified by all honest parties. And then the next time he tries to distribute something, he can only distribute bottom. So it's kind of like you can only harm the protocol a little bit, but only once, right? And that will be the key. So the picture of the protocol will be something like this. The honest parties start at very different positions in the beginning, and then they converge. And the amount of convergence depends on how much the corrupted parties try to cheat, but they can only do it once, right? And in the paper, we can show that on average, we can shrink the interval by a factor of 1/r, and therefore achieve our result. So going back to my initial picture, we do an expansion to r to the r slots, and then we cut, and then we achieve this in O of r rounds probability, except like agreement, except with probability 1/r to the r. Here are some numbers, like for small thresholds of corruptions, our protocol is actually pretty fast, I would say, but for large corruptions, there are some hidden constants, right? This 1/ε factor that is hidden. Okay, thank you.
Questions? I have a question. Maybe I miss it. What assumptions are you using?
Yeah, in the paper we need to use like a really good coin, right? That's crucial. Yeah. So okay. We need some trusted setup for threshold signatures or unique threshold signatures, something like that. Yeah.
Okay. So another question is when the threshold is optimal with optimal threshold, the error probability is just too high.
So the best you can achieve with BA is n/2, right? We have this small gap, 1 - ε n/2, right? So please close this gap, right? Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, Let's thank you. The speaker again.
Thank you.